What's going on? Still hanging out at the Orient Center for Indigo Conservation, but it's not the only animals you guys are conserving, as I found out, Dr. Bowley.
That's right. We also have some work that we're doing with the striped newt.
Striped newt. Where are these endemic?
To Florida and Georgia.
Okay, very cool. So yeah. Northern Florida and Southern Georgia, is that how it goes?
That's correct.
All right.
Who is more being found in this, even as far south as central
really?
Florida? Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, so who is this project in collaboration with?
There are about a dozen zoos that are part of this project, and what we do is we're breeding the striped newt. Here are the adults.
I'm just gonna peer over the top there.
They're really cool.
Yeah, they're awesome. Now, look at this, guys, little newts. A blooming newt is what my mom would say.
Blooming newt.
Yeah, man, that is so cool.
Another one here. So they live in ephemeral ponds. And so when the pond, an ephemeral pond is a pond that dries up every year.
Oh, okay.
And so it's like a big puddle. Really.
Okay.
And when the pond evaporates, these newts will then become terrestrial.
Is that what they call an F? What is the
first,
F stage?
The first year when they become terrestrial, they're an F.
Okay.
And then when the rain season happens again and the pond returns, the newt comes back to the pond. And they become 100% aquatic. And
So when they become 100% aquatic, are there morphological changes? Are there things that happen to them? Or is it just they take back to the water?
They take back to the water.
So they always have a flattened tail, even when they are...
when they become terrestrial, like an F, the tail will become a little bit more round, less flattened. And then, yes, when they go back to the water, it starts to paddle up again.
That's pretty cool. Yeah, that's amazing, because that's like almost like evolution in real time.
Yes.
You know, that's incredible.
And when they hatch, and we'll see them on their side of the river, the babies actually have external gills like an axolotl.
Really?
And as they mature, those get absorbed, and then they breathe, they just do cutaneous breathing when they're in this stage.
Cutaneous, so that means through the skin.
Yep, they breathe through the skin.
Wow. Now, can they stay submerged indefinitely with cutaneous breathing? They can.
Yep.
So they're getting enough oxygen out of the water, if that's, what, diffusion? Is that what it is?
Yep.
Wow, that's incredible, because I know some North American painted turtles can do, they can stay submerged for 6 months with cloacal, with capillary
gas exchange, yep.
But if the animals are a little too active, their oxygen requirements become too great, they have to breathe or respirate normally. So these guys, they're fully adapted to an aquatic lifestyle and can stay submerged as long as they need to, as active as they're.
That's cool. Yeah, totally cool.
Yeah.
So when they lay their eggs, we'll go ahead and separate them out. I need to put my glasses on to see them.
Oh, really?
So
I'm getting to that point too. Am I going to? Oh, is that slime? Is that the sludge?
So you'll see there are little tiny.
Look at this.
There's one.
So I don't know if the GoPro will pick them up, guys, but perhaps you can point to where you were looking. That's an egg. Hold on, they got a handy dandy pointer. That's an egg right there.
There's an egg.
That's it.
Yep, they don't lay a strip of them like frogs, or they don't lay a big glop. They just do a couple at a time, and as we pick them up, we put them in here.
Well, that's what I was looking for. So some of the algae that you had, I was like, oh, maybe that's some of the egg slime that amphibians normally have. But now with these guys, water quality is paramount, huh?
Any aquatic species, water quality is paramount. Exactly right.
Wow, that's crazy. I mean, so oxygenated, obviously. Some of these, are you just propagating plants in these?
Correct, because we're trying to make a more naturalistic enclosure for these guys as well.
Yeah.
So some of these plants have been through, they're going through a quarantine process, make sure we're not bringing disease in on the plants.
Gotcha. Some of the problems that amphibians, why I shy away from keeping amphibians, is skin issues. Can develop pretty quickly. They have a sensitive skin. Are they not? Frogs and some newts are indicator species, right?
Yes, they are. Yeah, having if you're breathing through your skin, or you've got that real slick surface for gas exchange, any small pathological change to the skin, you start to get a little callus type of lesion. Gas exchange doesn't work very well because you thickened it up.
And, yeah.
It's kind of like having lung disease for them.
Wild. So. For you as a veterinarian, are these difficult animals to treat if they do get sick? The best thing to do is not get sick, right?
Yeah, it's pretty tricky. Just their size alone makes it difficult. Yeah. You can't do too much.
Yeah. Crazy.
And as the eggs hatch out, we start with the babies over here. Let's see if we can see where the small ones were up here.
Holy smokes, there's really...
Right in front of those.
Oh, here they are. Here they are.
Zipping around.
Yeah, those guys are... Get out of town. Can you guys see this? These are like on fast forward, man. Those are not fish. They're actually larval newts.
You see the external gills?
They do, yeah. And then they're starting to get, some of them are starting to get legs. That is, man, what a project you guys have. Here's some more.
Let me separate them out by size.
Will they eat each other?
They will if we don't pay attention. So here's little tiny ones.
That's a tiny newt right there, guys. That's bizarre. I don't think I would even be able to identify them as a newt if I came across that in the wild.
No.
That is so, I don't know what I would think that is. Like, I'm not really big on my amphibians, guys. I gotta do a little bit more work.
These guys here are a few months old and they've absorbed their gills. And they're starting to look more like mom and dad, but they're just smaller in size.
Wow, that's pretty sick. Yeah, that's pretty cool. And so you guys are, these are actually being released back into the wild.
Correct. We release them up in the Apalachicola Forest. We partner with the Coastal Plains Institute, and they coordinate all the release efforts. Here's
some here more babies in there. Right on that PVC. Really cool. Very simple. Again, it's about the husbandry, the ease of husbandry. I'm sure all this water is what? Filter? I see you have a big water tank over there.
Yeah, we start with our own water, reverse osmosis water, and then we'll reconstitute with some solutes to bring up some tannin-type properties.
Okay.
We don't use tannin for the color, although some facilities do. We haven't found a need for that.
So tannin-rich water would be a more acidic water, right?
More acidic. They do like it acidic, but it also tends to be brown, kind of a tea color,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So we do buffer it to try to keep it down on close to 6.
Okay.
pH, yeah.
Yep.
So slightly acidic. Some facilities even try to get the 5s.
Wow.
But,
it's amazing, man. Down in South Florida, we have a lot of alkaline water. I guess that's just the nature. It's coming up through
here
limestone.
Here it's alkaline too. That's why we have the buffer.
Okay. There you go. Makes sense. It's good for fly river turtles, but not for amphibians or this particular species.
This particular species. Yeah.
Awesome, man. All right, I just want to show you guys there's more going on here at the Orion Center for Indigo Conservation. Thanks to Dr. James Brogan. And that, of course, is Trevor Mia. He's just kind of hanging out on this one, guys, but it's all right. We like having Trevor around. He introduced me to indigo snake conservation, so really stoked on that. All right, guys, let me know what you thought of today's video, and I'll talk to you again real soon. Bye.